The decades after the United States gained independence, the country expanded westward into lands inhabited by Native Americans or previously colonized by other European powers.
All the while, the U.S. Postal Service grew to meet the demands of the growing nation.
As the U.S. Postal Service itself expanded, private businesses began contracting with the post office for mail delivery services.
During this period, westward expansion created a need for the Pony Express, a postal route stretching 1,966 miles across the country, connecting Missouri to California.
Riders delivered mail by horse in a relay style, stopping at stations along the way. This mail delivery method was a temporary solution, lasting only 18 months while the telegram line was being built. Daniel Piazza, curator of the William Gross Stamp Gallery, gave me a tour of some of the museum's stamp collection, including original stamps from the Pony Express. Daniel, tell us a little bit about what we're looking at here.
What we're looking at is a proof sheet of postage stamps that were issued by the United States Post Office Department in 1940 to celebrate the 80th anniversary of the Pony Express. Proof sheets are some of the first sheets to come off of the printing press, and they're used by employees in the printing plant to check the quality of the print, make sure that everything is printing correctly before they actually start printing millions and in some cases billions of postage stamps.
Do you want to tell us what the Pony Express was?
The Pony Express was an early attempt at uniting the United States mail over land by using a relay system of horse and riders between California and Missouri. And there were a series of stations all across the American West where then the next rider and a fresh horse was ready to take the mail on to the next station. Till the Pony Express in 1860, the only way that mail could travel between the East and the West Coast was by ship. It had to go either around the tip of South America or it had to go over the Isthmus of Nicaragua.
So there were some issues, though, with encroaching on Paiute land?
Many native people in the American West saw the Pony Express stations as kind of the beachhead of advancing and encroaching American civilization. They were attacked, the stations and the riders, culminating briefly in what's sometimes known as the War of the Pyramid Lake or the Paiute War in 1860. And the Pony Express was very much a flashpoint in those conflicts.
How long did the Pony Express last?
You know, when I give tours of this gallery, I think probably the thing that surprises visitors the most is just how short a period the Pony Express actually operated and how little mail it actually carried. So the Pony Express lasted only about 18 months. There's a lot of romantic lore about how the Pony Express kept people who had moved west in contact with their families, and there's some of that, but very little. Most people did not have $5 to send a letter.
Why do we have this romantic sense about the Pony Express even today?
You know, it's not just us today who have this romantic idea of the Pony Express. Buffalo Bill Cody and his Wild West shows featured the Pony Express and advertised that a number of his performers were former Pony Express riders. Whether they were or they weren't is kind of iffy. Within maybe 20 or 30 years after the close of the Pony Express, already it was being romanticized. The West has always had a certain appeal, especially for Easterners, and I think the Pony Express just kind of ties into that lore, and it has carried it for over a century and a half.
Why did the Pony Express end? What caused its demise?
What really put it out of business was the arrival of the telegraph, and now messages and information could be sent electronically from one coast to the other without the need to use horse and riders and relay stations.
How do you think mail will be delivered in the future? Drones? Maybe spaceships? Let us know down in the comments section. And if you like this video, be sure to follow STEM in 30 on Facebook and Twitter and subscribe to the National Air and Space Museum's YouTube channel.